Good morning, New Hope Fellowship, and those who are going live stream with us and who later on look at YouTube. Praise the Lord. It's wonderful in the park. If you're not here, you're missing the beautiful beauty of God's cathedral right here, New Hope Fellowship, San Dimas Canyon Park. Anyway, it's so good to see you guys, and praise the Lord. You know, it's still the Christmas season, and we're going to be sharing a Christmas message and even singing a few songs. Why? Because it's God's entry to save humanity. Christmas is all about God seeking and sacrificing for us. But before we go any further, would you bow your hearts with me and let's thank the Lord for his goodness and his presence that's in us and here in the park as well. Heavenly Father, we thank you for all that you do. Lord, you came to seek and to save the lost, like me and all this world. We thank you, Jesus, that you came because of the Father's love. Holy Spirit, have your way here. And in those who are listening live stream or later on YouTube, thank you, Lord, for your goodness and your grace. In Jesus' precious name we pray, and everyone would say,
Amen.
Amen. Amen. God is good. Amen.
Amen.
You know, the Bible says, sing to the Lord a new song and praise in the assembly of his saints. Psalms 149. And I just want to say, I wish everyone had a Merry Christmas. And as Pastor says, we're still in the Christmas season. And you know, because of that one silent night that a Savior came to give us hope, to give us peace, to give us healing, to give us strength. And that's what we want to sing today. But we're going to do it from our hearts, meaning no music. And I want to hear you guys, because I want to encourage you. When you praise, there's healing. When you praise, there's strength. When you praise, there's a whole multitude of things that happen in your life. And I just want to encourage you. We all know this song, Silent Night. We just celebrated it. I don't know if you guys saw his star on Monday, how bright it was and beautiful. So I'm encouraging you. As we just sing, we're only going to sing the one verse over twice. But I'm encouraging you, sing it from your heart. Remember that night that he didn't come just to come, but he came for a purpose. And that purpose is you and I, to give us a hope and a future. Amen?
Amen.
So if you want to sit or if you want to stand, but we're going to sing this morning. Amen? Ready?
Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, crown young virgin, mother and child.
One more time.
Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round young virgin, mother and child. Holy infant, so tender and mild, sleep in heavenly peace, sleep in heavenly peace.
We thank you, Lord, and we praise you for that silent night, Lord. We worship you and exalt you, Lord God, that you would move upon, Lord, our hearts here today and those that are watching, Lord God. Lord, speak to us this morning, Lord God. Lord, even in the situations that we may be facing right now, Lord, whatever it may be, Lord, you can still speak to us, Lord God. Give us that open ear to hear your voice, open heart to receive, Lord, and give our minds the clarity, Lord, an understanding of what you want us to hear, Lord, and to see through your words this morning, Lord. And we thank you, we praise you, and the church says, amen. Amen. Lord God, We thank you. We praise you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
This is my worship, this is my offering, in every moment I withhold nothing, I'm learning to trust you, even when I can't see it, and even in suffering, I have to believe. Say it's wrong, then I'll say no. If you say release, I'm letting go. If you're ready with me, I'll begin. And when you say to jump, I'm diving in. If you say be still, then I will wait. If you say to trust, I will obey. I don't wanna follow my own ways. I'm done chasing feelings. Let your fire fall.
thank you, Lord, for your spirit that leads us this morning, Lord God. We thank you. We worship you and exalt you, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord.
Yes, oh God.
You know, this next song, I think, is a new song for all of us. But you know what? It says, praise the Father, praise the Son. That's why he came, to give him praises. And no matter what you're going through today, let's praise him for everything he's brought us through 2020. No matter what we faced, he still provided for us. He still kept us. We might have struggles, but he's held us in the palm of his hand. Amen? So I just want to encourage you, let's sing this last song together with all our heart. Amen?
Oh, sovereign God, oh, matchless King, the saints adore, the angels sing, and fall before the throne of grace. To you belongs the highest praise. These sufferings, this passing time, under your wings I will abide, and every enemy shall flee. You are my hope and victory.
Amen. Hallelujah. Praise you, Lord God.
that there is no other name, Lord God. And I thank you for your spirit that's here, Lord God. I thank you that you would touch my brothers and sisters where they need a touch this morning, Lord, whether it's physically, spiritually, mentally, Lord, financially, Lord God. I thank you that none of us are going to leave this place the same as we came in, Lord God. Lord, we thank you for your healing power that's in this place, Lord God. We thank you for the peace of mind, Lord God. No matter what we go through, we thank you that you hold us, Lord, in the shadows of your wing, Lord, in the palms of your hands, Lord God. Lord, and I thank you that your spirit that's here, Lord, would flood and inundate this park, Lord, and touch every single one that's here, Lord God. Lord, and again, I thank you and I praise you for your glory, Lord. I thank you for the message that's going to come forth this morning, Lord, that you continue to speak to us, Lord. And it's in Jesus' name we pray, and everyone says, amen. Amen.
You may be seated. Amen. Man, wasn't that delicious? That was awesome. Thank you, Bam and Bessie. Didn't you enjoy it, you guys? That was awesome. You who are listening and going live stream with us. Now, the beautiful thing is so much is beginning to happen. You know, a lot of good stuff. We're seeing the vaccine come out, rolling out slowly but surely. And we're looking at having a better 21, right? Amen to that. But we are still, we're looking at going one more month here in the park into January. Now, so we really need your prayers. It's a little cool, but you know what? Hey, it's cool wherever you're at. I mean, you can throw a little heat on, but I mean, hey, it's still good, amen? I mean, if you're that cold, bring some blankets. Barbara brought some blankets. There's others that brought blankets. We got people with polar bear hats on. You know, so it's all good. And so thank you for coming. And you that are listening from home, thank you for dialing in. The beautiful thing, too, that we have as a body of Christ, and that is we know that we're in Christ and that we can come to him anytime and give him our cares. Now, a lot of us have cares, and that's normal. And the good thing is that the Lord wants to take those cares so that you don't feel it all. I mean, God puts responsibility on all of us. It is your responsibility to make good choices. Sometimes we get in a poor situation because we make poor choices. But God wants you to make one good choice, and that's to follow him. He says, if you follow me, I'll make you fishers of men. But there's another translation I saw that says, and you'll adventure with me. I like adventure. We're going to be talking about how God came down to seek you and I, but also to sacrifice for you and I, so that you and I will have a better, fulfilled life. Here's my tech man. Thank you, Greg. He's good. He says, if you can you hear me now? Okay. I can, really? Okay. Thanks, Greg. We're trying all kinds of cool stuff at the park. But anyway, thanks again, Greg. So, hey, I just want you to just bow your hearts with me. You at home, bow your hearts as well. You're going through stuff. You have things that you're looking at your new year. There's finances, there's health issues, there's relational issues. And God wants to go with each one of us in each one of those situations. There's some of us that have lost jobs. There's some of us that, you know, they're just things that are going on and only you and God knows. And maybe you don't even realize what you're going through. But maybe even at this time of prayer, we call the Gap Ministry here at the church here. And by the way, this is church. We're not in a building, because a building is just a building, but the church is this, his people. That's the church of Jesus Christ. Not a nice building, not where you have all the smoke behind you and all the other stuff. This is the church right here. And you who are listening, you're part of the church as well. So bow your hearts with me. Let me lead you in a small little prayer, but it's now at the end, it's up to you. Are you going to give to God what's on your heart? People that are part of your life or things that you're going through, give it to the Lord and know that he's going to take you through your valley. Read Psalms 23 slow and then very slow. I told that to a dear friend, Jenny Garcia. Read Psalms 23 slow and very slow, because in that psalm you see you're going through the valley and he's with you in the valley. He's with each one of us. Father, we thank you for your goodness, your grace, your kindness. Lord, the goodness of you, O God, is beyond description. For only you are good, as Jesus said.
about God, Father, Son, and Spirit, who we praise and worship this morning. We love you, Lord. We thank you for coming into our world, into our very lives. Those who have called upon the name of the Lord, they are saved now, even before they're in heaven. But now in this journey, Lord, we go through stuff. We have relational issues. We all have those because, Lord, we're the biggest problems. We can see the splinter in people's eyes, but we can't see the beam in our own. Forgive me, Lord, when I'm judgmental. Forgive me, Lord, when I'm not considerate of my wife or others. Lord, we all can say that. And Lord, where there's physical needs, such as Jenny Garcia and others that are working through even this COVID in their family or friends they know, we would just ask, Lord, that you heal and protect not just our loved ones and friends, but, Lord, those who we hear about. We just pray. We pray for those in leadership. We pray, Lord, that you give them a heart to seek you. Now, Lord, we take this time to cast our care on you. Friends, it's think real quickly where you're at right now in your life. Cast your concerns to the Lord. Would you do that right now for your sake? Thank you, Lord, that we can stand in the gap right here in our heart against the enemy that would try to destroy lives in different ways. And we build that gap through prayer and faith and know that greater is the Lord Jesus who's in us than the enemy and his minions of darkness that would try to destroy loved ones and our very life. Thank you for this morning, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray, and everyone would say,
amen.
God bless you.
Again, just a few announcements. I hope everyone had a great Christmas and getting ready to say goodbye to 2020 and welcome 2021. Only God knows what's in store for 2021. Amen. But on that note, remember to keep our nation in prayer. Like Pastor says, our sister Jenny in prayer. There's many more that needs prayer here. I know our sister Alice. I know my dad. And there's many more. Our sister Consuelo, her husband. There's a lot of things we could be praying for. So I just want to encourage you always to pray. Even if you feel in your heart, God put someone on your heart within the church, give them a call, because you just never know what your prayers or your words can do to that person. And you know, about prayer, I just want to encourage you guys. You know, I know a lot of times we sit on our chair or whatever and pray, but we should really learn to get on our knees and pray and seek God. And it hit me yesterday when my sister shared, there's a brother that we talked to, has bad knees, barely can walk, but yet he always gets on his knees to pray. And when she, you know, I heard him tell me, I get on my knees every night and pray, and I don't think about it, and I go, okay. But when she said that, it really hit me. And so I want to encourage you, because you know, I know some of us have bad knees and all that, but we could really try, because I bet you once we get on our knees, you won't feel that pain. Put a pillow there, I don't know. But I just really want to encourage you, even in this year. Okay, I'm being told to lift the mic. 2020, you know, we all been through 2020, but let's make 2021 a better year. One where we draw closer to God, on our knees, seeking him daily. I'm encouraging you, like Pastor says, we'll probably be like this another month. But when we go back on Wednesday nights, I really want to encourage you to get on our Zoom for prayer. It's only for 1 hour. And it's really not even a whole hour, because we kind of just go around, pray, and then we kind of go into our own closet like what we would do in church. So I just want to encourage you on that. Remember, even when the women's Bible study gets back going on Mondays, link in, get in. I'm encouraging you guys. Pray for our youth. Pray for the homeless ministry. There's so many things we can be praying for. Pray for all the pastors around the world that are still struggling, trying to get their churches meeting somewhere, because there are a lot of churches like us that are renting from other buildings and we can't go in. So pray for those, the congregation. Pray for the missionaries, because just like we got impacted with the pandemic and finances, just think about these pastors that gave up everything to go to these countries where there's not a whole lot of finances. So they depend on us. So I'm encouraging you on that, to pray for these people. There's pray for our president, pray for our vice president, our police officers, firefighters, our doctors, especially the hospitals right now. So they're inundated with so many patients. So again, there's so many things we could be praying for. So we cannot say there's nothing to pray for. Amen? How many know it's good to give to God?
Amen.
I'm encouraging you, and you've heard my story time and time. God comes first in my checkbook, before my house payment, before my car payment, whatever it is, he's the first check I write out. And God has never failed my wife and I once. He's always met our needs. Even like I told you, in 2008 when the economy was crashing, they contracted my division out where I work. I got 2 furloughs. I got a $6 pay cut. But yet, I still have my home to this day because my wife and I trusted in the Lord, and he was the first paycheck to go out. Credit cards got on the back burner, and they got paid when they got paid, but God saw us through. So I'm encouraging you. Start 2021 by saying, Lord, I'm going to trust in you, and write out that first check to him, and I guarantee you'll see a difference in your life. All the way around, no matter what. So again, we have a box back here if you want to donate and give your offering here, or if you want to just go on our website at newhopefellowshipsandemas.org and just follow the link, and you can go that way as well. Amen.
Thank you, Bam. Our children are going to be dismissed for children's. They're going to stay. Okay. All right. We're going to stay. If we want to talk about 2 points in the sermon this morning. It's a Christmas message. It's, you have in your notes, it's Christmas reveals a seeking God. So take your notes out and you'll be able to, okay, the youth are going to go, okay? Yeah, all right. And let's see here. This one's a little higher. That one's shrinking. Okay. Can you hear me? Can you hear me at home? I heard that some people were watching last week, and I turned my head and the message would go away because I guess this thing is picking up a little bit. But we're working on some new sound equipment as well, where, you know, you have the fancy doodle that hangs over your mouth, right? The big fancy churches have that. We're not fancy yet, but we're trying. Amen? Okay. So, but we want to talk about the title of the sermon, as well as the theme and the Christmas message here. The title is Christmas Reveals a Seeking God. We're going to look at how God seeks us, and we're going to see that about the Christmas time. But also, the text is Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1 through 4. It's going to be interesting to see in this package of just these first 4 verses in Hebrews, you see the purposes of why God came. And the theme here is Christmas reveals a seeking God who endeavors to speak to us, and a sacrificial God who's willing to sacrifice for our good. And the proposition, I always like to give a proposition. You don't have it in your notes, but for those listening, here's the proposition. When anyone accepts God's greatest gift, Jesus Christ, then believers will be encouraged as they listen and hear from him on a daily basis and enjoy the goodness of life through this gift in Jesus from God. You know, most people, as we've just celebrated Christmas, we enjoy Christmas. I enjoy Christmas. I think most people do. And, you know, the lights, they remind me of the Father's love from heaven. He sent Jesus. And so, I mean, you think about it, when the angels appeared to those shepherds, it lit up. I mean, these angels spoke to these shepherds, and they went to see Mary and Joseph and the baby, and they were excited. When we see these lights, there should be an excitement, because what's the meaning of these lights? It's about the reason for the season. It's Jesus. Now, some of us, we like Christmas because it's after Christmas when all the good deals come across, right? The ladies like to get out there and, oh my goodness, well, hey, these are good sales going on. Although everything has changed with COVID-19. You don't get out, and if you do, you keep your distance. Even here in the park, there's many here, and we're
separated except next to loved ones, and we get that. And you know, some are wearing masks, some are not, but I'm into hugs, but like this. Give me a hug. And some people, they say, well, I don't care. I've been good all this time, and so give me a hug, and I'm okay. I feel pretty good. But some people say, how can you do that? Well, we take the chance, and we love one another. But I want to talk about Christmas, the reason why God came. He came to seek us and also to sacrifice for us. So if you have your Bibles, would you turn with me to Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1 through 4. Just four verses. We're going to talk about 2 points, and we'll break those out in just a minute. But Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1 through 4. And you're going to see why God came. He came, and you're going to see in these four verses here. And he at one time spoke through prophets in the Old Testament. And eventually God says, no, I'm going to speak through my son. And in fact, even Jesus brought about parables where he came to his vineyard, and he sent to his vineyard. You know, there's churches called Vineyard, the Vineyard, Vineyard churches, like Calvary Chapels. But anyway, Jesus said, I sent servants into my vineyard, and people who were around that vineyard, they disrespected those servants that were trying to get their benefit from that vineyard. And some of them they killed, Jesus said. And finally, he said that my Father sent the Son, and then they murdered him. And what would the Father do to those who were disrespecting the Son? Well, the true answer was, he will destroy them. If you have the Son, you have life. If you don't have the Son, you don't have eternal life. And those that may be listening for maybe the first time, I don't know. But if you have Jesus, you have life. And if you don't have him, well, he loves you. Call out to him. Repent from whatever you've done wrong, and ask him in your heart. And the Bible says you will have everlasting life. So let's look at Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. And I will read, so listen out. God, who at various times and in various ways spoke in times past to the fathers by the prophets. And you say, who's the fathers? These were the Israelites, and these are also people, the chosen people, the Jews, that God spoke to those fathers. And eventually he says, and in these last days, we're in the last days. The Bible says these are the last days. You say, well, what do you mean, the last days? They are, and we're not going to break that down for you too much here. But he spoke to us by his Son, whom he has appointed heir of all things, through whom also he made the world. Through Jesus, God created the worlds. He created the worlds. Those that are asleep at home, wake up. Those that are asleep in the park, wake up. Just kidding. Don't fall asleep while we're getting the word. I mean, what if all of a sudden Jesus would stand here and he'd say, hey, I've got something for you. I'm not interested. Be interested. Because you know what? God will bless you abundantly if you are interested. Whom being in the brightness of his glory and the express image of the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high, having become so much better than the angels, as he has by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. God's purpose wasn't just to enjoy Christmas and have fun and presents. He was the present. He was the main deal. He was everything that God had planned for. So I want to talk about that first point you have in your notes. We have a seeking God. All can respond to him. All can respond to this call. You know, in this very first verse, it says that he spoke to our forefathers by the prophets. We have the Old Testament and the prophets. It says you have the Torah, then you have prophets and the Psalms. God speaks to us by his word. And also, too, you say, well, he's just speaking to the Jews or the Christians. Listen, he speaks to all people. In Romans chapter 1, verses 18 and 19, men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness because what may be known of God is manifested in them, for God has shown it to them. You say, well, God hasn't spoken to people. Where's the preachers? God's speaking all the time to people, but they can't hear. And you know what? Christians sometimes can't hear at all because they're so busy, just like the world. It's up to us to listen to the Lord. And, you know, you say, well, would you speak first to me? You've heard people say, well, I don't have any friends. Well, why don't you make friends? Well, how? You speak up first. Well, they don't say hi to me, so I'm not going to say hi to them. Proverbs says this. Proverbs chapter 18, 24, it says this. A man who has friends must show himself friendly. And there is a friend who sticks closer than a brother. That's the key. The key to for friendship is to show yourself friendly. I'm not going to say hi here. They never say hi to me at church, so I'm not going to say hi to them. This is an unfriendly church. Well, why don't you make it friendly? Why don't you say hi to people? See, God, the Bible tells us, 1 John, in the Epistle of John, we love him because he first loved us. See, God took that first initial step to show his love. He's the one that stepped into our world to say, I'm here because you don't know how to come back to me, so I'm going to come to you. He seeks us. He loves us, and he came here in the person of Jesus Christ. God, the Son of God, became a son of man for you and I. He who created this world is not a hiding God. He doesn't hide. He came to us. God never, his intention wasn't to never hide. In Chronicles 6:30-31, it says this. They're talking about God. Would you hear? See, God sees the heart, and it says this. Then hear from heaven, from your dwelling place, and forgive, and give to everyone according to his ways, whose heart you know. See, God knows our hearts. You alone know the hearts of the sons of men, that they may fear you and walk in your ways as long as they live in the land which you gave to our fathers. God has given us a desire to know him, and he knows your heart. And sometimes people just say, well, you know, he doesn't listen. He always listens because he sees your heart. But he made the initial step, but we can't hear him because we're so busy. Understand this fact. God wants to talk to you today. He wants to talk to you and I. He wants our time. Pam was talking about prayer. In the new year, you know, we took the month of December in our Wednesday. We called it the Gap Ministry, gathered against powers of darkness. These powers of darkness wants to separate families, marriages, friends, the church. And we're going to, the beginning of January, we're going to be starting our Gap Ministry on Wednesday. Now you can join it through Zoom. And then when we get back in the church, we're going to be going down into the basement type, and we will have that again. And we're going to be picking up our men's ministry as well. We want to get back. But right now, the enemy has used this darkness of COVID to separate many families and friends, and some have lost their lives. We take this very seriously. And even when we go down the basement, we're still going to be doing the CDC rules by distancing and staying healthy. And if you go down there even now, it's ready to go, and there's signs everywhere how to stay safe and appropriate. But you know, we're going to go down there and enjoy one another. This thing is going to pass. Now, again, like I said, God spoke through the prophets, but that was in the past. Now he's speaking to us by his son. And we read, how did God speak in the past? He spoke to Abraham himself, and then he spoke to Moses, the burning bush. Then he spoke to Samuel. Then he even spoke to Balaam through a donkey. God wants to speak to us. And I'm not going to say that God will speak to you through a donkey, but God's speaking to you all the time. God has not changed. See, Jesus Christ, in Hebrews chapter 13, 8, the Bible tells us Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He doesn't change, but we change because we follow him. We're the changing factor. God has a purpose if we seek him. You see, in the beginning, what happened was at the garden, God would fellowship. Just, you know, this park is so beautiful. If you're not in the park, boy, you're missing it because it's beautiful. And yes, we're a little chilly, but you know what? I'm sure you're chilly at home and you probably have a sweater on at home. Bring the sweater here. Come. Why not? But God spoke in a garden to Adam and Eve, and what happened was, is that they wanted to do their own thing, and they took their eyes off of God, and they wanted to follow their own. Well, they were tempted. They were tempted by Lucifer, and God came speaking to them and seeking them, and they couldn't hear him anymore like they did in the beginning. Right in that beginning, God, he called Adam. He called Adam man, and that also meant generically, Adam means male and female. And he said, where are you? Where are you? God wants to fellowship. He's a seeking God. Today he's still seeking, and he's still a speaking God. He's still seeking us. And you may say, well, I got Jesus. Oh, great. That's awesome. But he's still seeking to have more fellowship. You know, I mentioned last week about our friend Phil, who's a Messianic Jew. And God was speaking to him with me just in a general conversation about not tithing your income like Bam was talking about to be blessed, but tithing time to take time with God. I'd not heard that. God spoke through Phil. God speaks all the time through all of us if we are willing to listen to him. And there again, John said this in the epistle, in the Gospel of John, John chapter 1, verse 14. The Word became flesh, and he dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, and the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. The Word became flesh because he came to seek us and to have fellowship with us. And then he came, and then he sacrificed for you and I. Why? Because he loves us. The Logos, we call the Bible, and but we read it, and there's the Greek word logos. Logos means a written word. But rhema means where God speaks. You heard a word. I heard a rhema from Phil when he told me about tithing my time of prayer with him. It's like, whoa, I hadn't heard that before. And that was a rhema to me through Phil. He's not a pastor, but he's a minister of the Most High like you are. And he spoke to me. I thought, wow, Lord, I don't spend enough time with you. I want to tithe my time more to you than my busyness of sometimes nothingness. I want to spend time with him and hear him. God is desirous that we seek him. You know, and when we do read the word, the Logos, the Bible tells us all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, right standing with God, that the man of God or woman of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. You say, well, I don't know. What does God want of me? Friends, if you read it with a hungry heart, you can read through this whole thing and you're not reading it from the heart. You know what? It just, I don't get it. When you're hungry, man, you can taste the word of God becoming a rhema to you. In other words, whoa, I got that. I heard that. I never seen that before. You've got to take the time. You don't take the time, you're not going to hear what God wants to do. And no wonder Jesus even said this, you have ears to hear, but you can't hear. He's talking to the Jews. And by the way, we can say this about believers too. You have ears. Are you, Bob, are you listening? I'm so busy, I can't hear him. I have eyes, but I can't see what God's doing around me because I'm busy, because it's about me, myself, and I. God is seeking you and me, but he also wants you to be that way as well. And we have a God who's intense to speak to us today. He's an intense God. You know, because he loves us. Will we take the time to listen? Will we take the time? He's not an inactive God, he's an active God. So, well, where's God at? I've heard people say that about, you know, things in their life. Where's God at? Where's God at? Well, why don't you seek him with your full heart? Because he cares about you. The written word, you know, you're going to hear God speak, not only through a sermon like this, but you're going to hear testimonies like I heard from Phil. And you're going to hear from God even in prayer. If you have that ear, I want to hear you. God, what are you saying to me today? And so mankind needed a Savior. He needed a Savior. And so, really, listen to this. Jesus was anxious to come. He was anxious to come. In the fullness of time, Jesus was born of a woman. Now, he always was, and he always will be. But he was anxious to come. In fact, here's something that, you know, we talked about this a few weeks ago, but if in your Bibles, if you know your Bible well, and I trust that you do, in Ephesians chapter 1, that the Bible says he saw us before he created the world, where you and I'd be today. In fact, here's something that I always like to share, that he's seen you and I in this time where this world is. And he saw you and I what we would be doing. He's the God who's Alpha. He's beginning and he's the end. He sees it all done. But for some reason, he has volumes written about your life and my life already. But it's your choice. Are you going to fulfill what he has purpose for you? See, God has purpose for every one of us, not just special people, because he sees everyone as special. That's why abortion is so wrong, because he has special, he has volumes for those babies that are conceived and given a spirit, but does not give the chance for them to be born. And then we could have had the remedy for many things, but God, he gives us choice, but not the choice to murder. And abortion is murder. I want to talk about two. Point two, we have a sacrificial God. Let's rest in the favors of that sacrifice. He sacrificed for you and I, that you and I may have favors. The Son of God, the divine, glorious one, came. He humbled himself. The Bible tells us in Philippians chapter 2 how he took the form of a servant, a human being. I mean, I don't understand it. In heaven, I don't know. But God became like you and I, because we were lost in sin, and he died on a cross. He took that price of death for you and I. Of course, I love sharing the scripture, and you know it very well. It's John chapter 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world. He so loved us. That's an intense word. That's a verb. He so loved the world that he gave for you and I, that whosoever believes in him, they should not perish but have everlasting life. I heard a little story about these Scottish prisoners in World War II. And they were at a POW camp, and they were building the river Kwai, building a bridge. And the Japanese were very harsh on their captors. And so as they were building this bridge, they would have to come and assemble together every morning before they went to start to build the bridge. And they had to give account for themselves and their tools that they had. And one Japanese prisoner was very harsh, guard was very harsh. He says, "We're missing a shovel. Bring out that missing shovel or else." And nobody, and all these men are standing there, nobody's moving. And he says, "I will start to shoot one after another if that shovel doesn't come forward." And all of a sudden, a prisoner came forward, and the guard, he put his gun aside, he took the shovel, and beat the man to death. And later on, as they went to the next station, they realized that they already had that shovel. It was never missing. But Jesus is like that guard who was part of the group. Jesus stepped forward to Jesus was like that guard. He stepped forward to sacrifice and save lives. Jesus was like that one. You see, we see also in Romans chapter 8, 31, it says this, "If God is for us, who can be against us?" Jesus is for us. "And he who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he also along with him graciously give us all things?" God has given us life because Jesus, he came to seek us from the Father's heart. He came to sacrifice for us and to come to that very front and say, "Take me." The Bible tells us that Jesus was that lamb that would take away the sins of the world. And so if you have doubt about God's love, see Jesus. See Jesus in this great love he has that he did on the cross. You don't have to doubt God's love because he showed it on the cross. That cross, in fact, I'm going through areas in my life, and I see myself too in that new life that the Bible tells us. Romans 6:11 says, reckon yourself as dead, as if you died in the cross, and the temptations of the world won't be as prevalent if you see yourself in Christ, what he did for you. He took what you and I could not do. He took that stand of death so you and I can have life and abundantly. Don't let the devil take what's yours. He'll deceive you through the mind. He'll tempt you through the mind. And if it gets a hold of us into our spirit and soul, we get in areas that are not right. Repent and turn back to the Lord. But the enemy, you think, because I have Jesus, the enemy can't touch me? Yes, you still may be in the prison camp, but you're not going to die because God's going to set you free wherever you're at. You see, here's the process too. There's people that might be listening that they've never asked Jesus in. Well, repent. Call on the name of the Lord to be saved. Here's the beautiful thing too, as believers, because many times we can't hear what the Lord's wanting to say to us every day, or a lot of the time. Then Lord, give me a hearing ear and a seeing eye to see your will for my life. Amen. God desires you to see that, because he has plans, not just for eternity, but he has plans today, that you may know this one who's come to seek you and me, and a sacrifice for you and I. That's what Christmas is all about. Christmas is about God seeking us. Not just Christmas trees. It should remind us of the Lord, but Christmas should remind you of a God who came to seek me in my brokenness. I'm not going to get into my testimony. Many of you have heard my testimony. I like to share my testimony because maybe it might just touch somebody's heart and say, well, I need that too. That's what happened to me years ago. But God came at Christmas. The Son of God became the Son of Man. That's called the incarnation. An incarnation where God changed, and he is still human and he's divine as well. He will always be. You'll see him in heaven and the sacrifice that he had for you and I. You and I don't understand. The Bible says there will not be tears in heaven. There may be people, just because you're a person doesn't mean everybody's going to heaven. If you have the Son, you have life. If you don't have the Son, you don't have life. There's going to be loved ones you won't see in heaven because they don't want him. It's their choice. That's where God gives free choice. They don't want him, and their choice would be to be separated from God. God wants you to make that choice to follow him all the days of your life. And when you stumble, get up and stop what was separating you from God and others. No one's ever died of humble pie. Humility, the Bible says, the proud will be distanced and the humble will be uplifted. And the humble heart would say, God, I need you. Come into my life. Help me. And even if you're a Christian, God has a purpose and a plan today. And so I want to close in a word of prayer with you, that even this morning, if there's a time to rededicate your heart, I mean, if you know that you're right with the Lord, great. If you know that you goofed up or something happened, you know, you told somebody off, and God, I want to change that too. Or if you have impure thoughts or there's pride, get rid of this stuff and know that he's sacrificed for you on that cross and came to give you and I a life that's full of joy and it's unspeakable. It's full of his glory. Would you pray with me, please? Heavenly Father, we thank you for your goodness and your grace. Lord, what can we say but thank you? Even in the songs of worship, we worship you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The three in one, we thank you that you love us so much. You came seeking us at that Christmas morning through that Virgin Mary to bring into humanity life everlasting through you, Jesus, from the Father's heart. And then empowering us by your Spirit to understand. And I pray blessings upon those in the park and those listening, that their hearts would be hungry to listen to what the Spirit would say, that still small voice that would say, I have a plan for you, Bob. My friends, Holy Spirit, have your way. Have your way in the hearts of those in the park here and those listening. If they've never asked you into their life, Lord, this would be a great time to repent. Lord, forgive me. Jesus, come into my life. and help me to follow you and give me a hunger for your word. And Lord, if we've fallen away, forgive me, Lord. I want to stay right with you, have a listening ear and a seeing eye of your love. I ask this, Father, in the name of Jesus. And everyone would say, amen. God bless you. Thank you for coming. We'll see you next week at the park. It's great here. Wear a jacket and bring a blanket. Bye-bye.